Good morning, church family. Scripture reading this morning before the lesson is taken from Acts chapter 15, verses 19 through 21. Therefore, my judgment is that we should not trouble those of the Gentiles who turn to God, but we should write to them to abstain from the things polluted by idols and from sexual immorality and from what has been strangled and from blood. For from ancient generations, Moses has been in every city, those who proclaim him, for he is read every Sabbath in the synagogues.
Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity to be able to come together as a church, as a family that loves you, and worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, I pray that we would spur one another on towards love and good deeds as we come together. And that means work. Father, I pray that you would help us to understand the work that is ahead of us, for the congregation to grow, for these pews to be filled. Father, we ask that your blessing would come upon this congregation, that we would roll up our sleeves and understand what we need to do to attract folks from the community in here to obey the gospel and to live as faithful Christians, our brothers and sisters. It's through Jesus we pray. Amen. I've been with you about 10 months now, and I was so glad to find a congregation that I immediately fell in love with, and I felt that love in return that came to me. And I know that this is a very loving congregation, and with a deep and rich history that the church has here. We're in our 98th year, and I know that what that means is that we have 2 years until we celebrate our 100th. And I've heard a lot of stories from a lot of people about the things that are going on here, and so I've wanted to, with the 100th celebration coming up, to kind of do a diagnostic here. I've had 23 years in ministry and all of that in a mission church, a small mission church up north, where there aren't very many churches of Christ at all. And so maybe I've earned my doctorate degree in missions here in some ways. I'm Dr. Doug in some ways, diagnosing what's going on with an outsider's perspective to try to understand and to try to help the church to grow in the best way possible. And so what I've come to realize is that there are a lot of people here who love 36th Street. And they want to see 36th Street thrive into the next century. They want to see things continue on for generations to come. But there's a lot of concerned people as well. Folks that are wondering, what are we going to do? And we'll go through some of that in just a minute here. But I realize that we're a sick church. We're not dying. We're just a little sick. But there's some ways that maybe medicine can be given to the church to help us out a little bit. There's a spirit of people who want to fix the things that are going on here, but they maybe need a little bit of direction and understanding about how it is that we can do that. And I'm hoping that with my outside perspective, I can able to give some direction in the way we can go in looking at the church in Antioch in Acts chapter 15 in particular. So one of the things that I realized is that 36th Street, I took the attendance list at one point and I went through everybody and who I thought was of certain age groups, and I realized that the baby boomers are about 71% of the congregation. And I could be off on a figure or two, a percentage point or two either way, but those who are in their early to mid-60s through their early to mid-80s, that makes up about three-quarters of the population of 36th Street. Now, that's not unique only to 36th Street. I think there's a lot of religious groups across the map that are facing the same kind of struggle, and we're going to be going through that here in just a moment to understand that. But some things that might be unique to 36th Street is that OVU has closed. And with that, the prospects of getting transfer growth of, you know, young students meeting, marrying, coming to 36th Street and having families, that's a little bit more difficult now that we don't have a Christian college just a few streets over. We also have a lot of churches of Christ in the valley, and sometimes that can be a spirit of competition. I think friendly, brotherly competition or sisterly competition, as we also understand. So that makes baby to believer growth and transfer growth very unlikely. But at the same time, we have at least a couple of newborns here today. And we also had kids that took off to a kids' worship in the middle of service, which is wonderful. That means that we've got all kinds of young folks that are beginning to come back and trickle back here. That's wonderful. But I think we need to be receptive and ready for conversion growth. That's something that we used to do at the beginning of our history that we got away from in those golden years of the church, when we seemed like everything was going well. And we wanted to focus in on our young families and everything that was going on here. And so we didn't focus so much on the conversion growth of what we needed to do, the campaigns, the gospel meetings, the things of the past that worked really well in the early part of our history, kind of went by the wayside a little bit. Culture had changed, community had changed. There's a lot of reasons for that. But we relied basically on baby-to-believer growth and transfer growth and let the other go. And now we're in a situation, a crossroads, where we really need to spend some time in doing that. So you're familiar with this graphic here. I've used this for a couple of months now, once a month, as we've done this particular sermon series. And we can also understand that things don't end at 2024. I just extended that line out. And so let's add another 10 years. Say it's the year 2032. That's 10 years from now. And so whatever age you are, add 10 years to that. If 3/4 of our group is baby boomers, if you're in your 60s, you're 70. If you're in your 70s, you're 80. If you're 80, you're 90 at this particular point. Where will we be in 10 years from now, and how can we prepare now for the kind of growth and the kind of church we would like to see going on 10 years from now? Last time I had spoken about planting of a church, if we were a church plant, and we started out with the resources that we have so many blessings that we have here at 36th Street. And last month, we spoke about some of those blessings, that if we were just starting out, look at the building facility that we have, look at the grounds that we have, look at the resources of people that we have with a deep Bible knowledge, many who are second generation or older Christians, and those that have met a lot of time to serve. That's one of the advantages of having a church that is top-heavy in baby boomers, is that they're retired usually, and so they have all kinds of maturity and experience with ability to give to the church in so many different ways with their time and their maturity and experience, and they're very generous in a lot of ways here. We have ministers that are committed to the Word. We have a food pantry and clothes closet. We have different ministries such as the Widow's Walk ministry that has started. And so we have a lot of things started that we can use and really grow with. But what we need to do is we need to connect the community to the blessings that we have. That's the connection that needs to happen. All these blessings, all this maturity, all this faith that we have, we need to somehow reach out into the community with it and make disciples. The church no longer resembled the community. I'm talking about the church in Antioch, first of all. If we go to the book of Acts, we can see the Antioch church. If you go up the Mediterranean coast there, you can see it kind of up towards the top of that map there. They recognized that they had a problem. The church suddenly did resemble the community. That was their problem that they have. It'd be a nice problem to have, suddenly to have everybody in the surrounding neighborhoods around 36th Street suddenly coming in here and saying, we want to worship here. And that was a problem for them in some ways, because they had always been a church with a Jewish background, We can back up a few chapters from chapter 15 to Acts chapter 11. This is right after Peter had done that wonderful sermon with Cornelius and his household, and the first Gentiles came into the church. And we see here in the beginning of Acts that suddenly Gentiles are getting ready to pour into the church that has largely been Jewish up to this point. It says, now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. So what does that mean for the character and the flavor here? Well, first of all, there might have been some early conversion from the folks that were there on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2 that had gone back home and were Christians suddenly, not Jews any longer, but Christians. But we see that there was a concerted effort after the Stephen in Acts chapter 7 when he was killed for his faith, and there was a persecution that scattered the believers. And it says in verse 4 of chapter 8 that they went everywhere preaching the word wherever they went. And so they went, but they only converted Jews. And so the church up at Antioch is all Jewish at this point. And so what does that do for the traditions of the church? What does that do for the makeup and the character, the flavor of the church that is there at Antioch? Well, first of all, everybody who's there is rooted in the Old Testament, in the law, in Moses, the temple, the priests, the sacrifices. They understand those things. It's all in their collective background. That's part of who they are and the makeup of who they are. And in general, you could imagine as these Gentile Christians are being converted and they're coming into the church, you can imagine that there's a little concern because things are no longer the way they've always been. What do we do here? So there's a concern. And so there's a growth that had been happening up to this point. You could imagine it was baby to believer growth. As they were teaching their kids, and the young people were beginning to obey the gospel, there might have been some transfer growth between cities as people moved and they looked up the local congregation. But there was a lot of conversion growth, but all that conversion growth had been with Jews up to this point. And verse 20 says, but there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists also, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. A great number. That means that they were suddenly flooded with Christians. They were believers, but they were from a Gentile background. This means that they were from a denominational background or pagans. They were coming from paganism. That means that they were the unchurched who were suddenly coming in and hearing about Jesus for the first time, obeying the gospel, and they perhaps began to overnumber those who were of the Jewish background who had been there since the beginning. And so this became a problem to them. They were believers, but they didn't follow what we had always followed. They don't seem to know what we've always known and done things the way we've always done them. And so in chapter 15 here, our main passage today, we see them sending Paul and Barnabas and with a few of the other brothers down to Jerusalem to talk to the folks there at Jerusalem and saying, what can we do about this problem? It says, but some men came down from Judea who were teaching the brothers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. In other words, you've got to adhere to the old traditions of when we were just a Jewish-only church, Christian church, before you can become a Christian. And after Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and debate with them, Paul and Barnabas and some of the others were appointed to go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and the elders about this question. But some believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees rose up and said, party of the Pharisees. So that means they were the Pharisee sect before they became Christians. And now they're Jewish Christians with a Jewish background. They rise up and they said it is necessary to circumcise them and to order them to keep the law of Moses. So here's the struggle that they have. Maybe with some of these same Pharisees, I don't know. From Mark chapter 7, and the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, meaning Jesus, why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands? You see, there's a big adherence to tradition when we have new folks that come into the church. And so how is it that we've gotten here after 98 years of existence? And some of these things that I'll be presenting here are not just unique to 36th Street. Some of these also go across the map to every denominational group, every Lord's Church, and we see that these things here. And so early on in our history, we can see that we had a lot of conversion growth. That's something that we can see. If we put 1942 on the map, this is the middle of World War II, and we can see that this is the time when the baby boomers, who make up 3/4 of our congregation, began to be born. We can say that that was 80 years ago from 2022, where we are now. And so, in other words, World War II is as far away for Evelyn and Sherilyn as, 80 years in the past, as somebody who was born in 1942 in the height of the Civil War in 1862. That's 80 years from 1942. That's kind of crazy, isn't it? But it kind of gives us a little perspective here. And so the baby boomers, those who are in their 60s to 80s, who make up 3/4 of our congregation, this is when they were born. And so we see that, I'll take 1952 for example. We see that this is when highways under Eisenhower started to come in. This is when air travel began to become popular. This is when TVs became affordable and people began to bring them into their homes. And there was only one, and it was a huge cabinet, right, that laid down on the floor. I remember seeing some of those. And so 36th Street was, 18 years old at this particular point. It was during World War II, and we can see that they were converting many from the community, and the community looked a lot like the church. The church looked a lot like the community. Conversion growth was what was happening at that particular time in history, and the Christians began to fill the old 34th Street, which started out as Pleasant Avenue, Church of Christ, so much that they actually planted Grand Central in 1952. And so Christians were coming from the culture or the community around us and coming into the church here. So let's fast forward to another generation, the baby boomers, our young adults at this point in 1965. They're beginning to have kids that are now in their 40s and 50s. This is me. My parents are baby boomers, they're 72 years old. I was born during this era. This is me. We were the first latchkey kids. We were the kids who were born under Vietnam and endured the Cold War as kids, knowing the fear that the communists could come in at any time and bomb us and invade us. But this is a time in the late 60s and so forth where the community began to be very turbulent. The culture became very turbulent with the church. Think of all the Vietnam protests and so forth that were going on, Woodstock, and the culture began to divide from the Lord's church and go the other direction. We see that 36th Street held on to truth during that time and weathered the storms of a very turbulent community. In 1972, it was growing so much that we built this particular building that is celebrating its 50th year currently, right now. And so preachers began to be localized during this time. There were a lot of other changes and things that happened during this time. But add in the next generation that comes, the millennials, who are in their 20s and 30s right now. And so the baby boomers were middle-aged at this point, and they became grandparents. And we see that this was what we call the golden years. During the 60th to 85th year or so of our church that meets here. I remember seeing the pictures of all the babies lined up, about 30 babies that were here at that particular time. There was all kinds of kids that were here, these millennial kids that were the kids of the Gen Xers, that were the grandkids of the baby boomers. And we see that there were all sorts of ministries. 36th Street expanded its staff. It expanded its building. It renovated its building. The young hearts began at this particular time to take all kinds of trips. And I hear people talking about all the trips that they did. But during this particular time, during the 80s and 90s, we see that the community, the culture began to become very divided. It wasn't just turbulent anymore, but it was divided from the church. The church stayed true. 36th Street held on to truth and continued to preach the gospel despite what the community and the culture was doing around it. But many Christians' hearts and minds began to be distracted by many of the leisure. Suddenly we had more leisure time than any other time period in history. And we began to lean on entertainment and other sorts of forms to use that time rather than converting souls. We began to rely heavily at this particular time on baby to believer growth and transfer growth and those old ways and traditions of gospel meetings and campaigns and the things that worked in the old days, we kind of went away from a little bit. Bring in the time of decline, where our 71%, our baby boomers, are retired and aging. They recall the old days and think longingly about the good old days when we had all these kids and the young families and the ministries. They began to look at the church as a refuge to escape a culture that was not just turbulent and divisive, but actually combative. They became the great-grandparents of the Gen Zs or the teens and younger who are with us now, the kids that we have. But there were a lot of things that were going on. The culture set out to destroy the church. And it with family and schools and the government and society, all those things are broken. And that's the age that these Gen Zs are growing up in right now. We move from an industrial age all the way up through the Gen Zs until we came to an informational age where the technology is increasing like crazy and life has become so fast-paced. What is it that we're going to do? And we have very little or no conversion growth going on whatsoever at this particular time. 36th Street is weathering the storm by holding on to truth and preaching the gospel as we should. But generations X and Y, the millennials, these generation Z, they realize that the church no longer looks like the culture, and the culture holds out all these wonderful things that they would rather be a part of. And so they've either left or gone to a different church, or they are seeking other spiritual ways, or sometimes just fallen away and there's nothing at all that they're involved with whatsoever. And so what is our growth now? With those young families having left, there's very little baby to believer growth. There's very little transfer growth. And so we must rely on conversion growth. We're going to have to find Christians that are outside of the church, in the streets and neighborhoods right around the church, and once again reach out to them with the gospel message. But our job has become more difficult. By grace, the community can come into the church. And so the Gentiles were flooding into the church at Antioch. And there were a handful of traditionalists we can see who were saying, unless they, you know, are circumcised, they can't become Christians. And so they're insisting that the community conform to the church. And so Paul and Barnabas and others go down to Jerusalem to talk to them, and this is what was said. Peter was there. The apostles and the elders were gathered together to consider this matter, and after there had been much debate, Peter stood up and said to them, "Brothers, you know that in the early days God made a choice among you that by my mouth the Gentiles should hear the word of the gospel and believe." He's saying there that it's God who did this, not me. Lest you think that I opened the door to the Gentiles and seem to have made this struggle that you're going through right now. Peter says, it wasn't me, it was God who did this. And then it continues on and says, "And God, who knows the heart, bore witness to them by giving them the Holy Spirit just as he did to us. And he made no distinction between us and them, having cleansed their hearts by faith. Now, therefore, why are you putting God to the test by placing a yoke on the neck of the disciples that neither our fathers nor we have been able to bear? But we, believing that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus, just as they will. And so it is by grace that they will be saved, not by traditions and adherence to traditions. So what about 36th Street? We must not insist that the community conform to the church that has never known the church. We need to realize that we live in a different culture and a different age. This here is church membership among U.S. adults across the board. This is every group, everything from the early 1940s all the way up through 2020. And if we go ahead and figure out that there might be a generation about every 20 years or so, we can throw that in and understand something about church attendance and the kind of community that we're working with as we go out with the gospel message. And so we can start with the World War II generation. If you're not sure what generation you're in, just think, what kind of music do you usually identify with? That will help you to figure out what generation you're in. But the World War II generation, those who are in their mid-80s and up, who came to age in the 1940s during World War II, and so we have very few of those left, sadly, but those were the folks that built our country. And so it's really the baby boomers we want to focus in on here, because they are the ones who make up 3/4 of our congregation. Those who are in their 60s to 80s, who came to age in the 1960s, you can see that it stays pretty level through those generations, through those particular years, that we're around 73% or so of all people in America who are going to church or any kind of religious group at that particular time. We get into the Gen Xers, my generation, and we can see that we came to age in the 1980s. That was the big hair, the, you know, guitar bands, heavy metal, all that. We are in our 40s and 50s now, but you see attendance beginning to drop there. The Gen Ys or the millennials, they came to age in the 2000s. They're in their 20s and 30s right now as we speak, and we can see that things begin to decline quite a bit. They're down to 61% or so by the year 2012 or thereabouts. And so you add 10 years, the Gen Zers, the kids that we have right now, and you can see that it drops below 50%, 47% across the board. So as we go out and reach out into the community around us, understand that these folks don't have an interest in going anywhere. It's not like we're just trying to convert them from error to truth. We need to convince them that they need to be involved and associated with a church body at all. That's part of the difficulty of what we're working with currently, right now. And so conversion growth. We're going to have to reach out to the denominations. We're going to have to reach out to the fallen away. We're going to have to reach out to the unchurched. And this means a lot of work. This is the hand we've been dealt. So how do we do this? We need to meet needs. And I think we're doing that as 36th Street. I think the centennial celebration is a way that we can meet needs and letting the community know that we're celebrating something big and we have hope to offer. We're going to have electronic signs soon that will allow the community to see all the things that are going on and maybe something there that might meet a need of theirs. We have the Widow's Walk ministry. And in just a week from now, next Saturday, we have the clothing giveaway. And I saw so many people there here yesterday working at the clothing giveaway and donating time there. There's ways in which we can interact with the community and find ways that they can satisfy at least a physical need at first, but maybe also begin to talk to them about a spiritual need, a spiritual hunger that is in each and every one of us, and offer things such as hope that the world can't offer. So we see here that we never want to compromise the truth of the gospel. Mark chapter 16, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. We always want to extend love, and this is going to be difficult. Tradition should not trouble those turning to God. Going back to Antioch, part of the solution that the council in Jerusalem gave them was, after this I will return and I will rebuild the tent of David, God says, that has fallen. I will rebuild its ruins and I will restore it, that the remnant of mankind may seek the Lord. And all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord, who makes these things known from of old. It's God who is behind it, and that's important to remember, that it's not just us going out with our own energy and effort. It's God who is behind it, and there are those who may seek the Lord, and we need to find them. As they continue there, he says to offer grace. Therefore, my judgment is that we should not trouble those of the Gentiles who turn to God, but should write to them to abstain from the things polluted by idols, and from sexual immorality, and from what has been strangled, and from blood. So the title of the lesson is, Should Not Trouble. We need to get the folks who are not here now out of the world, and then keep the world out of them. And so the solution for 36th Street is to offer grace. And that's going to mean some difficult things. People are going to be coming in with some difficult life situations. There might be some language that we might hear as they're trying to become more Christ-like. There might be kids that are out of control, never been churched, don't know how to sit still. Where are the next elders and deacons and teachers and preachers and parents and families and future from 36th Street going to come from, if not from there? These are pictures from our golden age. But what will be the next golden age that comes about 20, 30 years from now? We don't know, but it's going to take work. And that work God gives us is called the ministry of reconciliation. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God, not us, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. There it is. We should not trouble them when they come. We got to roll up our sleeves. We've got work to do. And that work is going to be difficult and hard. But if the church is to thrive into the next 100 years, this is what we need to do. The church should never be like the culture, but once again, it should look like the culture. A culture of repentant sinners who are trusting God to fix up their messed up lives while they learn from accepting, but not approving, Christians teaching them about Jesus out of love. If this is you, you've never obeyed the gospel, this is an opportunity to do that. Find out what you need to do. Study with one of us. If you have obeyed the gospel, but you've been sitting back, and it's time to roll up your sleeves, and you want the prayers of the church, the encouragement of the church to help you, this is an opportunity as we stand and sing that song of invitation.